incredible.
Incredible.
Talking about praise.
Praise.
Incredible.
Incredible.
Oh, praise.
Praise.
Incredible.
Amen, 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 amen. This is our third night. And we're going to bring it home strong. Amen. We got the praise and worship team ready to go. It is 7:01. We're going to open up with some songs. The invocation will be done by the Reverend Hubert Harris. Scripture will be read by the Reverend Brother, by Brother Robert Harris. And we'll take it from there.
Father, and bless us in the way that you see we're standing in need of. Father, look on the sick this morning, this evening, my Father. Help them to understand and realize, my Father, you are able, my Father, to heal all matter of sickness. Look on Terrell Brown, my Father, who asked for prayer this evening, my Father. And I know, my Father, that you will hear and answer prayer. Have mercy upon him right now, my Father. You know him and you know all about him because you made him, my Father. Have mercy right now. Not only Brother Blair, my Father, remember all the sick all over your land and country. Let them know, my Father, that you never fail, my Father. Have mercy right now. Not only those that are sick, my Father, look on those, my Father, that don't even know you in the part of that sin. Help them to understand and realize, my Father, one day, soon or late, my Father, we all got to stand before you in the day of judgment and give an account of the deed that has been done in our bodies. And so for that call, my Father, we ask to have mercy right now. Father, look on church and church connections everywhere, my Father. Lead and guide your leaders, my Father, so they can lead your children in the right direction. Help them to be like Paul, my Father, when Paul said, all I do is plant the word, my Father. And Apollos come back and water the word, Father. But we know that you're the one that brings the increase. Have mercy right now. Look on Pastor Crutcher and his family, my Father. Continue to hold him in the heart of thine own hand. Lay his members one by one, my Father. Look on those that are weak and look on those that are strong. Help those that are strong that is similar to those that are weak. Have mercy right now. Then, Lord Jesus, look on my daughter tonight, my Father. The Reverend Dawn Harris, my Father. Help her to hold on to your unchanging hand, my Father. Because I know, my Father, that you are able, my Father, to bring us in, my Father. Have mercy right now. Look on each one in the building tonight, my Father. Remember every family member that is here right now, my Father. Help them, my Father, to ever look to you for which cometh our help. Because all our help comes to you, my Father. Then, Lord Jesus, look on me who feel the least of all, my Father. Sometimes I'm up, sometimes I'm down. Sometimes I'm right, sometimes I'm wrong. But you know all about it, my Father. Have mercy right now. We need you, my Father. We can't get along without you. And then, Lord, look on the priest man tonight, my Father. Help me to preach your word in such a way, my Father, that somebody would come out of the wicked way of life and come on to your side and live. Have mercy right now. Bless, Lord Jesus. Bless your whole wide world, my Father. Have mercy right now. And then, Lord, when it's all said and done, my Father, and we can no longer stay in this side, my Father, help us to be up lived in such a way, my Father, that we'll be able to hear your welcome voice saying, well done. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Come up a little higher. And we'll be so grateful, my Father, to give you all the praise, you all the honor, and you all the glory. It's all in your Son Jesus' name. And for his sake we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you, God. Thank you.
Over this week, I can honestly say I've been truly blessed. I've been truly blessed. I've had my health. I've had peace of mind. awesome worship with good friends, family. How blessed can you count yourself when you look back over your week and you find so many beautiful things in it? You know, it's just awesome. It's just awesome. And I'm looking at the date here, and I know today's the 17th, and today is my 22nd wedding anniversary. And one would say, you know, what are y'all doing? You should be on a cruise. You should be heading somewhere. But we love serving the Lord. And, you know, me and my husband, it's just, we love serving the Lord. So we could go anywhere at any time, but when you have an opportunity to just worship, I choose worship any day. Amen. So I'd like to just take this time to just say to Brother Robert Harris as he comes to bring us the scripture, I love you. I appreciate you. And I know it has not been easy being the first man of any church, but you carry it very well. Come on, read the scripture. Amen.
Good evening, saints. I will be reading for you from the King James Version, 2 Corinthians 5th chapter, the 12th and the 15th verse. And it reads, "For we commend not ourselves again unto you, but give you occasion to glory on our behalf, that ye may have somewhat to answer them which glory in appearance and not in heart. For whether we be beside ourselves, it is to God, or whether we be sober, it is for your cause. For the love of God, love of Christ, constraineth us, because we thus judge, that if one die for all, then we're all dead. And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them, and rose again." Word of God for the people of God. Eat it, consume it, but most of all, live it.
Is to our God. I was about to say, brother, you can grab the mic if you want to. I mean, you can get it.
Let's do it again. Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah to our God.
amazing thing. Because to be honest with you, I do this every Sunday. All day long. Play every role. Amen. Good training for the soul. Thank you, Lord. Amen. We're asking for everyone who can and who is able to stand with me for $25. Is that fair for us? Wow, didn't that sound strange? Is that fair? Always made me wonder, what if God decided, you know, maybe I won't blow breath this morning. Is that fair? Or maybe if he decided lights don't need to be on this afternoon. Is that fair? When I put it that way for one reason and one reason only. I remember there was a time when I wasn't a giver. I wasn't a giver because I wasn't taught how to be a giver. I wasn't taught how to bless the house and how to bless the leaders. But then I realized little things would happen in my house. My car would break down on the road and come home and I'm pushing the garage door, and I know this ain't never happened to nobody in here. You know how you push in the garage door and you need electricity for that to happen for you, and it's just not happening for me. I've been in places and times when my daughter called me, Ma, what happened to the water? Come on now, come on. You know, it's little things like that gives me the unction. That you know, to understand one thing, if I got it, I don't have a problem giving it to God. Because I know he's gonna pour me out. And he has poured us all out many blessings. I know the Bible said a blessing. And some of us still waiting on that one blessing, and we done miss all them other blessings that he done blessed us with upon blessings. So we'll have the choir come first, or you all just pass it around up there. Y'all march down. Are we just gonna pass the bucket to y'all up there? Or I like to see y'all march. Y'all don't want to march? I like y'all to march. Come on. Come on. I want to see y'all march. Amen. They're gonna march just for little old me. God bless y'all. Amen. We don't have no ushers in the house. Look here. Y'all are not. Look at her. See, she ain't gonna do right. I know her. Y'all ain't marching, y'all don't know how to. Come on now. There you go. See, look at my husband. That's a marcher right there. What? Y'all understand? One thing for sure, we were trained really good.
Thank you.
all things come of thee. Father, we thank you for your bountiful blessings. Father, allow it to go out and bless. Be a blessing to the giver and to the receiver, Father. Multiply 100-fold, 1,000-fold, 2,000-fold, according to our needs, God. Father, I know you're not a God that is petty, so I know whatever is in that bucket is going to be multiplied at least 2,000 times its worth. And whoever planted into that bucket will gain it back over 4,000 times into their bosoms. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Things come up. Dynamic, dual, awesome couple, beautiful people. They're y'all know some people like that? Yeah, me too. And isn't it a blessing? You know, when I look at Reverend Juanita and her beautiful smile, you know, she just brings me so much comfort, peace, and love. A sister. A sister. Of course, I'm her big sister. I'm old. She know me. I love her. I love her. And for Pastor Mark E. Crutcher. I know I might have shared this story with him, but I'm going to share it with you guys. I was at the conference. I was a licentiate. And I remember I had just went before the bishop, and he had just, you know, gave you your papers, and, you know, you feel good because you got that little paper in your hand, and, you know, you got in black and white and looking like a press usher, and we just felt so good. And there was Pastor Crutcher, and he was preaching by the blood of the Lamb that covered all of our sins, and the way he was delivering that word, I was in awe, because all I could do is stand there with my eyes wide open, and I was absorbing every word as he just spewed it out of his mouth, out of his spirit. It was nothing but the Holy Ghost, and I accepted every single word, because when he said it, I knew that Jesus died on the cross for me. You know? And that's over 10 years ago. And I still remember that sermon that he preached that night. When I say, I'm bringing to you a dynamic man of God, an awesome teacher, preacher, loving husband, grandfather, friend. Friend, there's days when I see him and it's like he can sense I'm on the verge of tears. And all he do is go like this. And I could just let the floodgates go. Y'all don't understand. Y'all got to understand, because he belongs to you. So I know y'all know what I'm talking about when I'm talking about these people. You know? I'm just going to present to you guys the Reverend Mark E. Crutcher after the next song. He's going to bless our souls. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Give God a hand all over the house. Oh, this a day that you don't call the name Jesus. My, my Lord. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come for a word from on high. And because you have a word, Lord, we surrender all that we are to be unto you. We ask that you use what you created, and God, speak to what you made. Then, God, help us to be receptive to what you say, and obedient to what you will, and thankful for what you've done. In Jesus' name, put your hand together and bless the Lord for being a marvelous and a wonderful God, a kind and a true God. Thank you tonight for being in the house of the Lord. Amen. I just got in, amen, from Tampa to the Sons of Allen retreat. Amen. Marvelous experience. Amen. We went over and shared with some of the men at the mission, men mission this afternoon. And God just did some amazing things in the midst of the whole experience. Come on, give God a hand for just being good. My, my Lord. I want to thank Pastor Dunn for allowing me to come to a church and to say a word. Amen. Amen. So thank you for letting me get in your pulpit tonight. Amen. And saying a word. Amen. Let's give her a hand. Amen. Amen. Thank you for showing up in the house of the Lord. God is a good God. I believe there's a word from the Lord. Amen. Amen. God is a God that speaks. I want to take your attention to our Old Testament passage, first chapter of, now from the 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter. My Lord. Amen. And I want to start with 28th verse. Eliab, David's older brother, heard David talking to the men and became angry with David and said, "What are you doing here? Who is taking care of those sheep of yours out there in the wilderness? You smart aleck, you just came to watch the fighting. Now what have I done?" David asked. "Can I even ask a question?" He turned to another man and asked him the same question. And every time he asked, he got the same answer. Some men heard what David had said, and they told Saul, who went with him. David said to Saul, "Your Majesty, no one should be afraid of this Philistine. I will go and fight him." "No," answered Saul. "How could you fight him? You are just a boy, and he has been a soldier all his life." "Your Majesty," David said, "I take care of my father's sheep. Anytime a lion or a bear can't carry it off a lamb, I go after it, attack it, and rescue the lamb. And if the lion and the bear turns on me, I grab it by the throat, bear, and beat it to death. I have killed lions and bears, and I will do the same to this heathen Philistine who has defiled the army of the living God. The Lord has saved me from lions and bears, and he will save me from this Philistine." My Lord. I want to choose a subject from you when the odds are against you. Sometimes life has a way of not being fair. And the enemy loves to stack the deck. You ever play cards with some card sharks? And people, buddies that have been hanging together for a long time? Yeah, they know how to set the deck while they're dealing. They can deal from the bottom in the middle of the deck. And if you ain't watching, they can do it quicker than you can watch them. Yeah. And they have a tendency to say something just before they flip the deal. And so when you, while your focus off, it just dealt you out of the game. They've got signals that they can tell each other. When one touch the top of his head and rub his head, he know whether he's going to play a diamond or a spade. They got it all laid down. And don't let him call. His buddy know the lead out at from the top. And they got the signals all laid out. And you just sat down, you know the deck is stacked against you. He pick up the deck and he handled the cards like you've been handling them all in life. And they just fall right in place. You can hear them ripple. My Lord. He got a smile on his face while they're dealing them. Because he's dealing you out. My Lord. And so sometime the deck is stacked against you. And because God is a God over all things but don't control all things, the enemy comes in and like to set the deck against you. But how many folk know that that's not a reason to give up? Sometimes you have to fight even when the deck is stacked against you. Now the funny part of it is sometimes you got to do it when it ain't even your fight. Now in the text, David, it wasn't even David's fight. David was not invited to the battle. His older brothers, three of them, were the one who went to war. And David was too young and left home. So it was not even his fight, because he's not even fighting age. He was the one caring for the sheep. And so David gets to the battlefield and finds out the giant has been threatening the armies of the Lord. The funny thing is this. All the ones that have gone to war are afraid of the enemy. The Philistines have set the deck against Israel. They've got Goliath, a giant, and they know the Philistines don't have a giant. They've got Goliath, who is of the bloodline of the sons of Enoch, that go all the way back to Genesis 6, when the daughters of men and the angels of heaven got together and had children who were giants in the land. And so this bloodline, which was supposed to be wiped out in the flood, somehow gets crossed on the ark. My Lord. And now the bloodline is pumped back up in the land of Canaan. And I know you sometimes wonder why God would tell folk, when they got to the land of Canaan, a loving and a true God would say, kill them all. And the reason why he said it, because the bloodline of the giants was still in the land. And the bloodline of the giants, which are the children who are half angelic and half human, were not supposed to happen. They were abomination in the sight of the Lord. And when the angels left their posts and came down to meet with women, they created monsters. And the giants were so big that they went to devouring even the humans. And so what happens is Goliath is one of the holdovers of the sons of Anak. He's 9 foot tall. I mean, he could go on in the NBA, stand on the court with the tallest players and make them look like shrimp. My God. And because they had a giant and nobody else did, now all of a sudden, see, the enemy loved to stack it to his advantage. He don't want to fight the whole war because he know he can't win it. So he sent his big champion out there, say, hold on, we can save everybody alive, and they just send a man to fight against me. And whoever wins the fight will control everything. My. How many folk know that the devil, when he think he got the odd stacked against you, start setting the deal up in his favor? And so all of the children of Israel, all the soldiers, all the battle soldiers are afraid to go to war. My Lord. And for 40 days, the giant has been out there talking noise, and nobody answered the noise. But how many folk know that God, God, he said, that there's somewhere in the word that said, and a little child shall lead them. How many folk know that God working even when you don't know he working? So Jesse at home with his, and he got three boys going to war, and he's concerned about them. So Jesse takes his younger son and said, look at him. Take this bread and cheese down there to the battlefield and give me a report to tell me how my sons are doing. I need to know my boys are all right. So I send you with. How many folk know that you went for one thing, but God had another assignment for you? My God. So David go, he ain't going to war. He going to take cheese and wine and to give a report back to his father. And so but what happened when he get there, David hears some, hold on, how is this happening? Why y'all letting this Philistine blaspheme the armies of God? Why y'all hiding and let him talk about the Israelite God like that? And what it said is, church, why you let these folk cut up and knowing God ain't pleased with it? My Lord. And so the giant stood out talking, and David said, well, tell me what would happen to the man that killed the giant. Now, if you ever thought, and rather than David worrying about who he was, David was more concerned, tell me what you do with a person, get rid of it. Sometimes you got to see everybody else's impossibility as God's opportunity. Maybe they're afraid because they ain't walking in the anointing. And maybe they're afraid because they ain't talking to the same God that you talking to. Maybe they're afraid because they ain't reading the word like you reading the word. My. Maybe they're looking for excuses for why they're not moving rather than the opportunities that God got for their lives. Maybe they're afraid because they're more concerned about themselves than they're concerned about glorifying God. God. And so the giant is talking, and David says, I want to know what happened. But his brother started attacking David. Now, here's what I find funny now. When Goliath was talking to us, you didn't have nothing to say. Now that your little brother done come here, you got so much to talk about. You jumping all on him. And this giant been talking noise for 40 days. And you ain't open your mouth. Yeah. You one of them big strapping brothers that he sent off the wall. And left the little boy home. How many folk know that some big things come in little packages? So the giant is challenging them. And it's not even David's fight. But sometimes you got to get in the fight even when it ain't your fight. Sometimes you got to get in the fight because nobody else is up to the fight. Sometimes you got to get in the fight because ain't nobody else got the anointing to fight the fight. Sometimes you got to get in it because ain't nobody else got a word to fight the fight. You wasn't invited to the fight, but you got there to see the fight is on. As a matter of fact, they didn't even think you were worthy to come to the battle. They didn't invite you. But David was used to that. Because you know when they got ready to anoint king, his own daddy didn't invite him. And when Jesse said, I come to anoint your son king. And so they lined up all other boys. And the prophet had to say, surely you got another one. Yeah, because it ain't now one of these. And God told me to come down. He didn't make a mistake. You got to have another son. And even his dad had to say, you can't mean my son David. Not the little one out there gathering the sheep. He too little to be king. How many times folk have underestimated you? They looked at you and said, you ain't up to par. You ain't come from the right neighborhood. You ain't come from the right family. You ain't got the right pedigree. You know, church folk get into that pedigree sometimes. Yeah, if your mama and your daddy wasn't kin to so-and-so or in this position, you ain't fit in. If you come from the wrong neighborhood, and folks say that you ain't up to it, They call you the one that, the expendable one, the one that you can leave out, the one that you can forget about, and ain't nobody gonna worry about it. They don't think much in you. They don't think you got a whole lot of fight in you. They don't think you can do much to help them. So they have a tendency to overlook you. But how many folk know that the thing you overlook might be the very thing you need? I heard somewhere in the word says, the stone that the builders rejected, that my father made it the chief cornerstone, the very one that they passed by, and the very one that they said couldn't do any good, and the very one that made it to the top. Anybody ever been overlooked? Everybody ever been left out? They invited everybody but you. But my God, I knows how to get you to the battle. Because God know he put a fight in you that the enemy can't handle. Anybody out there know you got a fight in you that the devil can't stand? And the devil hoping you don't ever find out what God put in you. Sometimes the odds are stacked against you. But my God, so you ought to go home anyhow. Last month, the odds was against Tiger Woods. He was back in the Masters race. Hadn't been in there in 15 years. And everybody said he ain't getting no more green jackets. But my God, say I got more in ya than the world know about ya. My God, say I ain't through with you yet. My God, say because they counted you out, I'ma count you in. My God, said sometime you have to go against the odds. Tell me one man, I went and got all his retirement and pulled it out of his retirement thing and went down to the betting place and put $85,000 that Tiger would win it all. My God, they call that a long shot. 14-1 odds. My God, they said we'll take these all day long. But my God, around Sunday afternoon, the same man that betted on the long shot went to saying hallelujah. They tell me when Tiger won, he got something like $2.5 million in the bank. Somebody ought to say, thank you, Lord. Woo. So David was the lone shot. The odds were stacked against him. His brother didn't think he was up to it. Saul didn't think he was up to it. Saul said, look at here, you're just a boy. He's been fighting ever since he was a boy. He well trained. He bigger than everybody. And so David says, don't matter. I'm still going to win the fight. What is it about this little boy that he willing to fight when everybody else is afraid, when the whole army won't go, but he think he can win the fight? He's just a little boy, but some in him tell him he can still win. My God. And so here's what you got to, if you go, when the odds against you, first thing you got to do, embrace the challenge. The enemy want to put fear in you so that you'll doubt what God put in you. The enemy want to remind you of all the things against you. So when you're looking at what's against you, you don't look at what's on your side. You remember when the prophet was with his servant and they were all surrounding. And he says, we're in trouble. The army is all around us. But the prophet told him, said, now look at him. I need you to look again. Because I need you to know there's more with you than it is against you. And the Bible said when he looked again, he saw the army still around him. But he saw another army around that army. How many folk know that my God will sometimes let you be the bait? And he'll let you walk into the trap, let you walk into the setup, so he can deal with your enemy.
Oh, my God, they think you are expendable, but they forgot that there was a mighty God on your side. His own brother said, what you doing here, boy? Where are the sheep? But you know what David should have told his brother? I didn't come here on my own. My father sent me to the battle. Every now and then, you got to tell Satan, I wouldn't have come bothering you, but my father called me and sent me to the battle. My father got me on assignment. You might not understand it, but my God told me to come. I ain't on my own. I ain't by myself. I got an almighty God that's on my side. Somebody say yeah. Tell somebody and say, God, it makes all the difference. My Lord. So you got to embrace the challenge by looking beyond the circumstances. The Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight. If David were walking by sight, he'd have been running away. But David was able to look beyond his circumstances. You got to understand that sometimes the circumstances is what's stopping you. Remember when Peter was on the water and he had overcome gravity to walk on water. But then he was worried about the waves. And when he started worrying about the waves, he started sinking. The enemy wants you to think because the odds are against you that you're out of the game. But how many folk know you just got in? And so you got to embrace the challenge. The second thing you got to learn to do is you got to employ the testimony. Yeah. You got to employ the testimony. You see, here's what David told him. Even when Saul asked him, and when the giant asked him out on the battlefield, said, why they sent a boy out here to fight me? They just insulted me by sending you out. And you come out here with a stick, because he had his staff with him. He said, am I a dog? No, David said, you're worse than a dog. You're an uncircumcised Philistine. My God. But you see, he messed up because he let David open his mouth. And he let him give his testimony. And see, here's what you got to know. The power that God saved you with 10 years ago is still alive. Because God is an everlasting God. And the word he spoke to bring deliverance 10 years ago is still alive waiting on you. And when you give your testimony, you bring the power of your past into your presence. And the same power that it blessed you 10 years ago will come bless you now. And what it did, David said, when the bear came, God gave him power over the bear. When the lion came, God gave him power over the lion. As a matter of fact, when they got hold to one of the lambs, I grabbed him by the beard or by the throat and pulled a lamb out of his mouth. And my God, the same God that let me deal with the bear and the lion, the same God gonna put him in my hand. Hear what David was saying? I wasn't at war travel with you, and I haven't been in the practice with your war game. But you need to understand this. While I was keeping the sheep, my God has been preparing me for the battle that I know I got to fight. And my God, got to look at him. I was a smaller boy than I am now. But when the bear came and the lion came, my God, I put him in my hand. And the same God, gonna put him in my hand. My God, it doesn't matter how big the giant, doesn't matter how large the problem, God says, I look down on all giants and all problems. They're all small to me. My God.
See, here's the thing. You can't let nothing become bigger in your eyes than your God. You got to be like Michael Jackson say, who's bad? Who's bad enough to mess with my God? Who's bad enough to handle my God? Oh, you think you bad? But see, here's the secret that David understood. The army thought they were Saul's army. That was their problem. David said he has defiled the army of the Lord. David knew who army he belonged to. He said, I ain't in Saul's army. They ain't even invited me here. But I'm in the Lord's army. And the problem with the church is sometimes you don't know who army you in. Yeah. You think you're in Mount Olive army, or in AME army, or in the bishop's army, or the pastor's army, or the elder's army. But you're in the army of the Lord. You serve an almighty God. You got to look beyond these small things. You got to look beyond minor stuff. And you got to go to the major. See, the enemy wants you to major in the minor. But my God, you tell him I didn't come here for small things. If I wanted small things, I'd have stayed where I was. But my God sent me to do some great stuff. How many folk know that God will take ordinary folk and do extraordinary things? My God, I'll take somebody that ain't up to snuff, and my God, I'll work miracles, mighty miracles, mighty wonders, mighty things, so that God will get the glory. So when David testified, the giant was already messed up. Because see, David was prophetic. And when you have a prophetic gift, and you can open your mouth, see, if he could have closed David's mouth, he might have had a chance. But he let him open his mouth. And when he gave a testimony, because see, when David speak, God is listening. My child just spoke. He spoke, first of all, of how I delivered him. And then David even got a little smarter. Not only did he testify, but he prophesied. He said, now the same God that delivered me from the bear and from the lion, the same God have put you in my hand. And this day, my God gonna turn you over to me, and we're gonna feed you to the birds. Matter of fact, the birds gonna eat pretty good today, my God. And so no matter how big the giant, there's just more birds gonna get fed, my God, because you got to see it, not you that's gonna win the battle, but an almighty God that's working through you. You have to tell him it ain't me, it's the anointing that's in my life. It ain't me, it's the anointing that God gave me. I might not look like much, but there's a whole lot that's inside me. I got more on the inside than you can see on the outside. I got more with me than you can see. My God, anybody know out there that God says you ain't seen your best, you ain't got to the top, you ain't seen all what I want to do with you? My God.
Last thing
you got to do is you got to engage your gifts. All right. Now, watch this. You don't get prepared for the battle in the midst of the battle. First of all, there's something in your past that will prepare you for what's facing you. And that's why you have to give your testimony. Now, the other thing David had to do was, they tried. Saul, who told him, you can't win, gonna say, all right, well, if you're gonna go, take my armor. Well, if your arm ain't gonna help you win, and you bigger than me, then why you want to put it on me? As a matter of fact, it's all you scared to go to. You the king, but I ain't seen you answer. So why you want to put your arm on me? See, folk want to tie you down with their stuff. Their stuff ain't going to win for them, but they want to give it to you. Why you want to give me what you can't win with? If you can't win with it, you want me to lose too? You trying to set me up. They would put that stuff on and say, no, this ain't for me. You might be the king, but you keep your arm. Yeah. And watch this. David said, I got to take a trip. Before he goes to the battlefield, he goes down by the brook. And he picks up five stone. Five smooth stone. And he puts them in his pouch. Why he gets smooth stones? The smooth stones have traveled in the river. They didn't start off right there. They broke off upriver somewhere. And they've been traveling down through the river. And they've been running into other stones. And every time they do, the edges get knocked off. You see, if you're going to throw a stone, what throws it off course is the edges, that it can glide through the air. And the smoother the stone is, the straighter your aim. I'm trying to tell somebody something. Them bumps and them knocks that you've been going through, them trials and them tribulation, God trying to smooth you off. Cut off the edges. Break off the rough places. Because God getting ready to launch you. And he said, I'm not going to miss my target. So I got to make sure all the rough edges, and I got to smooth you off. See, he got stone that's been through some tribulation. See, that's why we can't win no battle, because we don't go through no tribulation. We bail out soon as stuff get tough. We bail out soon as folk tell us we ain't up to it. We listen to them and rather than God. We some of us won't even get in the fight. And because of that, when the fight come on, we don't even know how to fight. And we turn tail and run. We do like a scary dog, put a tail between their legs, and we go running. Yeah, devil got us running. We were made to chase the devil out of here, but the devil run us out of church. I ain't going to that church no more. I ain't singing in that choir no more. I ain't going to usher no more. I ain't going to be on the steward board. I don't want to be a trustee no more. Even to the point that some folk are, I ain't preaching no more. My God, Jeremiah tried that. Jeremiah said, I ain't going to even call your name. But after a while, Jeremiah said, I tried to keep quiet, but it like fire shutting up in my bone. The more I shut up, the more it burns. Anybody ever burned in the power of our God? Say yeah. So David got five stones, and he heads to the battle. So, in other words, you got to use your gifts, not somebody else's gifts, but the ones God gave you. David been walking with a sling all of his life. He been out there practicing with the sling all of his life. See, now watch this. The enemy never recognized David's weapon. His eyes was on the staff. He said, why you come out here with a stick? Or you gonna beat me to death with that stick? And while he watching the stick, David winding up the sling. Oh God. And so you got to understand this, that while the enemy think he knows how you gonna fight, God got another avenue. He got the stone in the sand. And Goliath talking noise. And David started winding up. While the devil talking noise, you ought to be winding up. I heard somebody say, the more you talk, the more I'm going to bend my knees. Talk about me as much as you please. Because the more you talk, the more I'm going to bend my knees. While they're talking about me, I'm going to go all on Jesus. Every time they say something against me, I'm going Jesus. Every time they talk about me going down, I'm saying Jesus. Every time they count me out, I'm going to say Jesus. Oh my God, Jesus, I need you, Lord, right about now. Oh my God, I heard, God, that you were God that would fight my battles. I heard, God, that if I call your name, that everything would be all right. Oh my God, somewhere in your word, I read, God, that you were God with all power, all power, all power in your hand. Yeah. David, why? And just when Goliath think he got the advantage, David releases it. Pooh! Hits him straight in the forehead. Knocks him out. But the battle ain't over. Because you got to remember, David says, not only am I going to hit you, but I'm going to cut your head off. Now watch this. David ain't even got no sword. And he talking about, I'm going to cut your head off. And he ain't even got a sword. But when he knocks Goliath out, David said, I don't need no sword. Because I'm going to take your own sword. You brought a sword here. You brought what I needed. You brought what I needed to cut your head off. I ain't bring it, but you brought it. God will make any man bring the very weapon that you need. David takes his sword and cut his head off with his own sword. My God. Oh, God. And you know what David do? He take the sword back with him. Take it back to his house with him. Goliath's sword. But hold on. He got 5 stone. But they only shot 1. Why you got 5 stone? Because Goliath got some other kinfolk out there. And when they hear that you done killed the kinfolk, and the devil coming again, don't you think it's just 1 battle? And the battle over with. But I heard God says you ought to keep some ammunition in your pouch. My God. So when another giant show up, you can tell the giant, a stone just like this, I kill your cousin. Goliath even had some brothers. I kill your brother with 1 just like this. And this in here got your name written on it. Oh, my God, when I got it out of the river, my God told me you would show up. Oh, my God told me he'll make a way out of nowhere. And then when you read the Bible, you'll find out that later on, they took care of Goliath's brothers and even his kinfolk. Not only did they kill him, but they got them other demons too. My God said, I ain't no 1-man show. I ain't no 1-fight God. You know, some folk ain't got but 1-hit record and they ain't never had another one. My God said, if I'm your producer, I'm going to give you more than 1 hit. My God, anybody out there know that because you fought yesterday, be ready tomorrow and even that night for the devil coming. But tell that devil, bring it on. My God, my God. See, I'm about to leave y'all alone. I'm like the preacher now in closing. I got to tell you about the long shot. The one who all the odds were stacked against. The one they counted out. There was a little baby born in Bethlehem. He was such a long shot that they wouldn't even let his mama in the inn. He had to be born in a stable. And they had the deck stacked so much against him when he had to run into Egypt for a little while. Now, see, he ain't run because he was afraid. But God said, I can't let you move right now. It's too early to show your power. I got to set this thing up. So just go on, take your power, and go on over to Egypt. And I'm going to take care of you, all your adversaries. While he down in Egypt, playing with his tricks. They tell me when Jesus was a boy, they counted him out. But they tell me he could and form it up like a pigeon and throw it up in the air. And the clay will go to flying. And then you see a bird fly in the midst of the air. My God. They told me even as a little boy, they brought sick folk to him. And the sick folk got well. See, he's working on his gifts. He's working on the gift that God gave him. He know one day I'm going to have to be what God created me to be. So I need to work on my gifts. What you need to do is take your time in between the battle of working on your gifts. You ought to throw some up in the air in the name of Jesus and see what God will do with it. My God, getting you ready for the battle ahead. The odds was against him. Somebody even said, if any good thing come out of Nazareth, my God, say if I put it in there, it's coming out with power. My God, they had the deck stacked against him. Satan even got one of his own to betray him. Got another one to deny him. Got the rest of them to abandon him. My God, they done whipped him. All night long, the odds are stacked against him. He a bloody mass. Can't hardly walk up Golgotha Hill, stumbling and falling. My God. And then when they got him there, they stacked it up even more so. They nailed his hand. They pierced his feet. My God. I look like in a bad place. My God, the deck is stacked against you, but I heard the thing they didn't do, just like David, they didn't close his mouth. My God, and because they didn't close his mouth, I heard him tell the thief, this day you're gonna be with me in paradise. I know it look like I'm going down. I know it look like I'm out, but this day you're gonna be with me in paradise. My God, I heard him. I heard him say, it's finished. My God, he dropped his head in the locks of his shoulder, and then he died. My God, they put him in a tomb. He was dead. My God, but early, early, early on Sunday morning, he got up with all power, all power.
Early, 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 early in the morning, he got up, borrowed two, what did he mean? Early in the morning, Mary and the other Mary, Mary and the other Mary, he said, go tell them, I'm going to be with my father. I will send a comforter back for you. Early! in the morning. You got to understand, when the spirit moving, you got to move too. If you ain't moving, there ain't no spirit in you. But you got to remember, my God don't play. My God, he'll wake you up early in the morning. He'll take you right down off that cross. Oh, my God. Early in the morning. My God. If y'all have never felt the spirit moving, y'all got to come closer to the fire. You got to come closer to the fire. When you're not feeling, you got to come closer. The altar is open. The altar is open. Come on up. Come on up. Yes, come on up.
Come on, trust him. Anybody know he got all power? I know the devil counted you out, but my God said I counted you in. They wrote you off a long time ago, but I heard God says, I wrote you in my word, I wrote you in my will, I wrote it in my word. I told the devil that I was going to make you be my child. Anybody out there, trust the Lord. Somebody tell him, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
You see, when you put your trust in the Lord, you got to understand one thing only. Keep your eyes fixed on the prize that is yours. Don't turn from the left or from the right. You got to keep your eyes set on Jesus. You got to understand one thing. Whatever he got for you, it's for you. It's for you. It's for you. Whatever he got for me, it's for me. You see, God don't play. He don't take nothing from no man. He give it all. You see, one time, you got to understand, if he did it for David way back then, what wouldn't he do for you? What wouldn't he do for his children? What wouldn't he do for us? You see, when I look back over my life and I understand clearly where he brought me from, I advise you to check your record and see where he brought you from. You see, where he brought me from, y'all might not have been able to survive. But my God, where he brought you from, I might not have been able to survive either. So you got to know, what God got for you is for you and only you. You understand? You see, them five stones took down five giants. One David, five giants. How many times y'all done killed the lion and the bear? And y'all didn't even know y'all was slain. How many times y'all, they tell you was that? You out, Deborah? Go ahead home, girl. Go ahead home. It's over. Go ahead home. You know how many times they done told me? Girl, you out, need to go ahead and close down Trilby. Let them people go. Ain't nobody there to let go. I'm there. I ain't turned around yet. I refuse. Nobody is going to make me stop praising my God. My God, you see? My God gives me testimonies like I can make all things happen because he gave me strength. He gave me strength. He keeps me going. He gives me love. He gives me peace and understanding. So when you say you got a one-man show, no. I know it's the God in me, that spirit, that Holy Ghost spirit that move in me that will not allow me to say no. Or shut nothing down that my God has placed me. You see, sometimes people try to talk you out of your blessings. You know, he talked about the car dealers. You know, the car, they try to trick you. They try to trick you. You know, they try to tell you this and they try to tell you that. Try to get you to walk away from God. That's a trick of the devil. Don't do it. never let them deal from the bottom of the deck on you. You guys, children. What was that, three-card molly? You flip it real quick, and all of a sudden you think you're looking at the queen? What? You gotta look closer. Your God will never let you choose the wrong queen. Yeah, I know about three-card molly. What you say? What? Yes. Y'all got to understand. God's been so good to me. I really don't look like what I've been through. And if you know that you don't look like what you've been through either, you got to keep giving God all the glory. Y'all lift your holy hands up and give God some praise up in here. Give God some praise up in here. Hallelujah. Because let the record show it, I should have one face skinned up, a scar coming down the side of my neck. I should have a couple of tattoos running around the back of me. Look at here. Y'all don't understand. When you done been through some stuff, you come out looking kind of rough and rugged. But let me tell you, them smooth stones. Yeah, I'm a smooth stone. I claim that. Because some rough edges done got, yes, they done got shaved off as I was rolling through the river. Yes. So now when I look at people that are about 55, they go, "That don't look crazy, baby. God will bless you too. Just trust and believe. Trust and believe. The altar is open. I know y'all are all members of this wonderful couple. Wonderful couple. And I just want to thank you all because I believe I see most of you out here tonight, every night. I saw y'all every night through this revival time. And this was hard. This was hard on my flesh. This was hard on me and my husband's flesh. But it's so worth it. It was so worth it. Y'all don't understand how much we love y'all. We need everybody. We need y'all to understand how good God has been. How much he has sown into our lives. And just being able to bring different voices. We heard the elders say, shake it off. David said, bring a new thing. You got to do a new thing. Because we knew. Pastor said, what? We slayed the dragon. David slayed the dragon. Y'all got to understand. When revival time comes, you should feel revived. And I feel revived. Amen? We won't keep you long. We're going to have the benediction. We're getting ready to go. Please hold hands because we made it through. In the name of Jesus.
hallelujah is praise. Hallelujah. Shown you that you're welcome. We've shown you that we are obedient to your spirit. We've shown you, God, that we submit ourselves to you, God. So now, God, I just ask if you move me out the way and you come on in one more again and have your way. God, first and foremost, to the shepherd of this house, my brother in the vineyard, Dr. Crutcher. Continue to pour into him and put a shroud of protection all around him and Reverend Juanita and their family, God, that they will stand boldly and declare and decree that the devil is a lie. And if he don't know it, he can continue to come here Sunday after Sunday because he's going to be made a lie every time he show up in this house. Give him the strength and the power, God, to proclaim and declare and decree that ain't no devil in hell can prevail against this house. Then, God, to this preacher that may think, she and her husband, that may fathom, oh, God, for one second that they're preaching to an empty church. I don't know all of your word by heart, God, but I know this. You said, but where there are two or three gathered in my name, there I am in the midst, God. Father God, I'm not the brightest, but I know that if she and her husband are there, there's at least five because there's the Father. There's the Son. And there's a Holy Ghost. And 3 + 2, God, makes 5. So I say, preach, preacher. Preach the gospel free and true. I know for myself, it ain't about me. It's about me taking aim as a smooth stone. Taking clear aim and know that I've been down that river, twisting and turning, and been bumped and bruised, and you've been through some stuff. And getting ready to go through some more stuff. But the more you go through, the smoother you're going to become. Folk going to get out your way. And God going to use their weapon that they showed up to use against you to bring them to their knees. To kill the devil in them. Because your aim is to bring everybody to Jesus. Not just the ones who want to be there. But the ones who also need to be there and don't know him. Use her right now, God. Use her for your glory. Use her for your good. Have your way, God, in her circumstance, in her prayer life, Father God, in her wishes, Father God. Use her, God. Then, God, as she continued to just pray and preach and teach, even in the midst of her tears, her sad tears would turn to joy tears because she knows that she's doing it for you and not for fame. Bless her household. Take care of her helpmeet. Take care of whoever's connected to her. Strengthen her heart, Father God. Don't let her grow faint, Father God. Let her know that her waiting is not in vain. Your words say that those who wait upon the Lord. As a matter of fact, the other translations say, they, who is they? You are they. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. You will mount up with wings of eagles. You will run and not grow weary. You will walk and you shall not faint. The devil is a liar and he cannot stop the wind beneath your wings. God, for this church, this cloud of witnesses here tonight, Father God, don't let them miss a beat, Father God. Every time the pastor opens his mouth to preach and teach, call them, Father God. Glory to God. Call them into an understanding to know that they came here to have an encounter with you, oh God. We're not trying to be popular. We're not trying to be famous. We're just trying to be effective so that somebody who's on the outside of the ark of safety will come to know you in a very real way. Then, God, when they know you, whether they're trustees, whether they're stewards, whether they're ushers, no matter what perch they may sit on or what pew they may occupy, remind them, Father God, that what they do, the work they do, is not about Mount Olive. It's not about Dr. Crutcher. It's not about Reverend Juanita. It's not about how important they want to be. But it's about the mere fact that every good thing and perfect thing comes from God. And if you love God, you work for God. And you can't work for God if you don't know God. And if you don't believe in who He is, tell somebody, run and tell somebody. And then don't be satisfied because you ran and told them. The sister who was thirsty for Jesus at the well, she was hungry for the Spirit. She didn't run and tell somebody. She ran and told them, and then she brought them back. Y'all better read this. Come on, Father. You got to go run, and you got to go tell, and you got to go bring back. That's your word. Every officer, you're not trying to be famous. You're not trying to be popular. You don't need to be liked. You need to be faithful, obedient, and effective. Can I say that one more time? God, hear me, God. Touch them right now. You need to be faithful, obedient, and effective. Anything else that's outside of God's will, God needs you to be obedient. He needs you to be faithful, and in your faithfulness, you shall be effective. I don't care if ain't but 3, 5, 6 people in here. It's not going to dampen Dr. Crutcher. I know him well. I know him well. For Christ he live and for Christ he'll die. You are to begin to emulate your leader. How will you know if you don't listen to who God sent? Come on, people, read your Bible. Father God, use each and every one of them in here tonight. The musicians continue to take their gifts, not their talents. Your gifts make room for you. It's good to be talented, but the Bible says your gifts make room for you. Lord Jesus, your gifts, not your education. This man is well educated, but you didn't hear his education tonight. You heard his gift. His gift is what made room in your heart tonight. His gift is what moved you to jubilation tonight. His gift should have brought you closer tonight, closer to God. Operate in your gifts. Find out what they are. Go through some more river runs and get your edges knocked off and get a little smoother. Let God bring you into your understanding, because your aim ought to be a smooth stone. So whenever the devil raises up against you, you know how to take the perfect aim and send him straight back to hell from, because he does know the way. Have your way in this place, O Lord. From the little to the most, from the minutia to the magnanimous, have your way. Some people in here going through some stuff because, Pastor, when I heard you doing what you were doing, I heard hearts crying in the spirit. There are people around this chancery going through some stuff that needs to be addressed. I know what I heard. I heard it tonight standing right there. I heard some brokenness. I heard some depression standing right there. I ain't even a hairy person, and these little hairs on my arms stood up. You got some people in here wondering why somebody done them wrong. You know who you are. But God wants you to know it's all right. He didn't just start working miracles tonight with you. This is what God does. God said he wants everybody in here to understand this. God is a can-do God. Serving a can't-do people. Y'all didn't get that. And we are a can't-do people serving a can-do God. See, when you can't, God can. I'm going to say that again. When you've done all that you can do, and all you can do is stand with your smooth stone self, that's when God begins to work it out for you. Let me close with this. On your behalf, Dr. Crutcher, ministerial staff, I want you to know this. Whatever you're going through, Leslie, whatever's causing your heart to be hardened, no matter how many tears you cry in private, I want you to know this. whatever it is, God done thought that thing through and worked that thing out.